Well, a very good morning to all of you, dear friend. It is wonderful to be together once again around the word of the Lord. And we are continuing with our mini series of what is the church. So if you will be helpful to keep 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12 to 31 open, literally the Bible open on your lap, so that we can go through it. We are developing an unhelpful culture of listening to a speaker without looking for ourselves in the Bible. It's always helpful to look at the Bible so that you make up your own mind if the preacher is preaching the word or is telling you his own thing. So please literally keep the Bible open on your lap if you don't mind, as we will be working our way through these 20 verses of 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12 to 31. Last Sunday morning we looked at what is the church, part 1, where we saw that the church is a holy nation and a temple of God in which it dwells by His Holy Spirit. Today we are on part 2 of what is the church, and we are looking at the church, a body with many members. One of the marks of an individual's maturity is a growing understanding of and appreciation for his or her own body. So it is in the spiritual life. As we mature in Christ, we gain a better understanding of the church, which is the body of Christ that we're part of. And the emphasis on the body life from our passage this morning is going to help us counteract the wrong emphasis on individual Christianity that seems to be growing around us, that leads to an isolation from a local church which is foreign from the Bible. In this extended section on the church as a body, we start from 1 Corinthians chapter 12 verse 1 to chapter 14 verse 40. The Apostle Paul is instructing his immature congregation on how to think about themselves as a church. How then are we to think of the assembly of believers? How are we to think about ourselves, CCPs, as we gather this morning? How are we to think about ourselves? In three of his letters, which is Romans 12, the passage that was read to us, and 1 Corinthians 12 and Ephesians chapter 4, Paul gives emphasis to the church as a body. And in each of these passages, he brings out the same three important truths, which are unity, diversity, and maturity. And these three truths forms the main points I like to make from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12 to 31. And the first point that I like to make is that unity of the church is God's design. It's not our design. It's not what we woke up one day and thought that, you know, the church that we're part of, we are to be united. It is God who designed the church to be united, to be one. So before the Apostle Paul addresses the problem of the Corinthian church, he affirms the undergirding principle that unites every congregation of God's people. He makes two important points worth noticing. And the first point is that the church is a constructed unit of many members. That's what the church is. It is a constructed unit of many members. And the one who constructed is God Himself. Listen to what verse 12 says of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. This is a powerful image. We normally don't think of our bodies as something that is made out of many members. We don't think like that. We take it for granted that the body is just a unit. It's just a one body. But it is a construction of many members that have been brought together to make up what you're looking at, the body. So, the Apostle Paul makes the analogy from the physical body, and he said, what God is doing is exactly like my physical body, like your physical body. In order for your physical body to function well, the members of your body, they have to agree. Do you agree? If the members of your body does not agree, hell breaks loose. You can't function. You can't do anything. These different parts that forms this body, they have to be completely in submission to my mind. So that when the mind sends the message, this is what we're doing. The body in unity, all the parts, focuses on that. And Paul said that's how the church of God should be. The church is one, and that is God's design. It's not our design. And all members of the church are part of the whole. We have no independent life or existence. I don't know if you knew that. You don't. You belong. You are attached to good enough of all people. God is great. I'm attached to you. Whether you like it or you don't, it's not your thing. It's God's thing. It's either you fit in or you get out of it. That's what He's doing, and He's not going to compromise for anybody. He's building the church, one body. This is great. I love it. So every Christian who is by definition united to Christ by faith also belongs to every other Christian in one body of Christ, which is the universal church expressed in innumerable local churches like Christ Church Pinetown. That's the church. That's what we're part of as individuals. So the second point that Paul is making is the theological reason for church unity. It is God's design, therefore God has the reason why it should be this way. Look at verse 13. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body. Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. I always wonder why these people who are big on being baptized by the Holy Spirit after you've been a Christian for decades, they don't talk about being baptized in the body. Because that's what the Bible is talking about. When you become a Christian, the Spirit of God makes you to be part of the body that God is building. And maybe you are a name. You need to be satisfied with just being a name. It's important. Okay. Don't want to be an eye just be a name. He's the one who blessed you to be what you are in the body. It's not my choosing, it's not your choosing, it's His choosing. So we are baptized in the body by the Holy Spirit. We become part and parcel of God's family. So regardless of our cultural or economic background, all who belong to Jesus become part of His body in the same way. There is no other different or special way. It is the same way. The Spirit baptizes every believer into the body and then indwells them from then on. It's important to understand that, as you'll see in the morning. So this is a crucial verse in correcting a major error of those who advocate Pentecostal theology. There are two stages Christianity of being saved and then later being baptized by the Holy Spirit contradict this verse, and therefore it's wrong. Romans 8 verse 9 adds this. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of God, does not belong to Jesus, you cannot be born again and not be indwelt by the Spirit of God. It's impossible. Because the definition of being born again simply means you belong to Jesus. And the Bible says if you don't have the Spirit of Christ, you don't belong to Him. So these two verses make it plain that every true Christian is baptized by the Holy Spirit, or they're not true Christians. In addition, every Christian is indwelled by the Holy Spirit by the fact that we were all made to drink of the same Spirit, says 1 Corinthians 12 verse 13. So don't ever let anyone tell you that you are not baptized or you do not have the Holy Spirit simply because you do not speak in tongues. The Bible says it's not everybody who speaks in tongues. And tongues were never meant to be the sign that you have the Holy Spirit to begin with. Jesus said, when the Spirit of God comes upon you, you will be my witnesses. He didn't say you will speak in tongues. That happened. But it wasn't a promise. You could say amen to that. But that's a good teaching. That's what the Bible says. So you are a child of God, indwelled by the Holy Spirit, baptized into the body. You didn't come by your own choice here. Maybe you thought you did. It's the Spirit of God who brought you to this body. And He's got a specific role for you to play here. Praise God for that. So if people say you don't have the Holy Spirit because you do not do this and that, or you do not speak in tongues, that is a false doctrine. And those teaching it are either quite ignorant of what the Bible actually states, or they simply false teachers. The second main point I'd like to make is that diversity of the church is our challenge. Unity is God's desire. Diversity is our challenge. You know why? Because we have to coexist in this body. You know, with rough-edged people are good enough. We need to coexist, and you've got your own rough edges, and the God who's constructing this body is not finished with either of us. So no one should think that He's perfect. You're not. The Master is still busy with you. He's still busy with me. He's not finished with me. He tolerates me because He sees me perfect in Christ. Just as He sees you. That's beautiful. It's wonderful when you just Let the Bible speak to you. And I don't have to be like you to fit in into the body. We're all different. We all have different temperament. And that's how the Master wants us to be in the body. Religion wants us to be all the same, to walk the same, to dress the same. And imagine how boring the church would be if we were all the same. Imagine everybody being like you. It would be disastrous. But God wants us the way we are. He made us with different temperament. And he's delighted that you are saved, you are baptized into his body. You're part of his body. Your mission is to identify your gift so that you can play your role effectively. Because if you're not playing your role, you're injuring the body. The body's not going to function effectively. Because you're not playing your role. If my toe is sore, I limp. The whole body focuses on that. If my whole body is well, I limp. Because I feel fit and healthy. So is the church. And verse 14 to 26 is divided into two. Verse 14 to 20 and 21 to 26. The first section is about the diverse members of the one body. First and foremost, Paul restates the foundational principle of verse 12. That the body is made up of many parts. In verse 14. Then he proceeds to the first error, which is for one of the parts to say, I do not belong to the body. Okay, imagine that the foot or ear should take up such an attitude. Paul's point is that even if that could happen, in verse 15 and 16 he argues that it will not make it any less a part of the body. Because you're part of the body. If my finger says, oh, I don't belong to this body of good enough, it's ridiculous. It's part of it. If it's cut off and it's rolling on its own, then it's useless. No one will pick it up. It's worthless. It actually looks disgusting. Can you imagine a big eyeballs just rolling on the ground? There is nothing attractive about it. There's nothing useful about it. It's just useless. It's like a nice face brick rolling on its own, claiming to be part of the building, while it's not part of the whole that made this building. It's not important. It's useless. It becomes useless when it becomes part of the whole. It's exactly the same with us as a church. My usefulness and my identity is tied up on being part of the body. Outside of the body, I'm useless to God. He's not building up Lone Rangers. He's building the church. That's what he's doing. So if I say, I'm going to come out of the church, you come out on your own power, you become useless and worthless to God. And he's not going to change to continue to build his body. That's a good word right there. With this kind of independent kind of Christianity that is growing around us, I don't know what Bible, what kind of the Bible the people are reading. You cannot be a Christian and not be part of God's people. You just can't. Because the Bible says the Holy Spirit baptizes you to the body. Once you become born again, he taught you to the body. He's not interested in rebellious individuals kind of Christians. He's building his body. So every part of the body has its own function and its own unique contribution to the body. No part can be the whole body, or there will be no body. You can't, some of us think that we are the whole. Have you met Christians that they think that, you know, they are the whole church? They're just all around it. The church needs them. The church doesn't need me, doesn't need you. We need the church. Without the church, we're useless. So every part is needed in this body. Verse 29 says, no part of the body can claim to be the whole body. You're just a little part of it. I'm just a little part of it. We are interdependent to one another in this body. And every part is needed, so no individual member should suffer from an inferior complex. Why? Verse 18 says, for God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chooses. I do not choose to be this member in the body. It's God who chose to make me to be what I am in the body. And it is my responsibility to keep that in mind, that I'm part of the whole. And verse 18 is a correction of the proud and selfish behavior of the Corinthians then and the church today. It's God who knows where you fit best, regardless of what you think. Be happy with what God has given you. If you are a nail that good enough need to scratch himself with, wherever he feels itchy, it's useful. I can't use any part of the body. When you feel itchy, you need your nail. So all the parts in the body, the members of the body, they are important. They are there for a reason. And Paul says, this is how we are to think of ourselves. Some of us, they like big trucks. You know, when you rush into the supermarket, they keep you behind, you can't pass them, and you get annoyed. You get to the supermarket, you don't get what you were looking for, because those trucks, they're the one that delivers the good. As slow as they are, as annoying as they are on the road, they're important for you to get what you need. And that's how we have to think about the church. There is no one who's less important in the church. We are all important, and we are put here by God. So he knows where you fit in best. And that goes both directions, in keeping you in a lower position than you think you deserve, or in giving you a position greater than you think you can handle. It's his business. It's not your business or my business. It's his business. He is the builder of the body. It is God that equips and puts each person in the body just where he wants them. Look at verse 20. So there are many members, but only one body. Where you are is where the master wants you to be. Just play your role there. God blesses us in the body for a specific role to play. The second section deals with the need and unity of every member. The need and unity of every member. If the danger of the diversity of gifts is that some feel inferior and imagine that they have nothing to contribute to the body, a second danger is that others may develop a superiority complex, which says to other members, I have no need of you. I don't need you. That's another danger in the body, which we need to guard against as a church. You see that in verse 21? are disastrous. The mistake, once again, is thinking that we don't need the church. We need the church. We desperately need the church. Against this, Paul argues on two grounds, still using the body metaphor. First, in verse 22, he says, the parts of the body that seems to be weaker are indispensable, necessary, or essential. And secondly, in verse 23 says, on those parts of the body that we think less honorable, we bestow the greater honor. Human dignity requires us to clothe the least presentable parts of our body. We are more concerned about those parts that are least presentable in our body. We cover them, we clothe them for their protection. They are not dismissed or ignored. They are treated with honor. Again, Paul said, so it is in the church. We are all important. We are all there for one another. In Christ's body, verse 24, says, God has so composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lacks it. And the way this can be maintained is that there may be no division. That's why unity is our challenge, or diversity is our challenge. We need to guard against any form of division, so that there may be no division in the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. Can you imagine if the church would be really structured like this? How beautiful that would be. That's what God is building. A body of people that love and care for one another. So there is no room for classification in the church. We don't separate people according to their cultural background or economic background. We are all one as a church. And this is the only way in which the body can function healthily and as an entity. We all know that when one part of the body, as I said before, suffers, the whole body can never be at peace. Have you ever seen someone who gets hurt and, you know, he continues laughing and the leg is burning and he doesn't care? You don't see that. Everything stops. But some members, they behave like they're artificial members in the body. They just don't care when someone else is hurting. And Paul says that shouldn't happen in the church. Verse 26 says, if one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoices together. And God has organized the church that way. If diversity is our challenge, we need to understand that in the midst of that challenge, we are members of one body, and the authenticity of the gospel is at stake. It's not my reputation or your reputation, it's the reputation of the gospel itself, through which we are saved and we've been made one of this body. That's what is at stake. So not only is unity of the church God's design and diversity of the church our challenge, but thirdly and finally, briefly, maturity of the church is a priority. Most of our problem in the Church of Jesus Christ in general springs out of immaturity. Once again, the Apostle Paul hammers his point home with the emphasis on you as he applies the teaching to the situation in Corinth. Two things to notice briefly. First one is that spiritual maturity helps us to know who we are. Spiritual maturity helped me to know who am I. Listen to what verse 27, 28 says. Now you are the body of Christ and individual members of it. I need to chew that over. I need to understand how does that work together. And the illustration is with me 24/7 is my body. So you don't need anybody to teach you how does that work. Look at your body and learn. So it is important for the congregation to know who we are in order to behave and function accordingly and in harmony. You're part of the whole. And there are no lone rangers, as I've said, in the church of Jesus Christ. Every believer really belongs to the body, and each one counts and needs to contribute. But what we contribute depends on God's appointment. Look at verse 28. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, and miracle workers, so on and so on. It's God who appoints us to the roles to play in the church. So the second thing to notice is that spiritual maturity helps us to function harmoniously. Help us to function harmoniously. Listen to verse 29 to 30. Are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, do all work miracles, do all possess gifts of healing, do all speak with tongues, do all interpret? The rhetorical question in verse 29 to 30, all expect the answer no. They don't. We are not the same, and we are not assigned to play the same role. Each of us are given different gifts for specific different purposes in the body of Christ. Play your role. I must play my role, and this body will function in a manner that honors the one who puts it together. If we don't do that, we're injuring the body of Christ. So the gifts of the Holy Spirit, both in their diversity and equality, are designed to express unity and harmony. You remember what Paul says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 to 14? He talks about Jesus when he ascended to heaven, is the one who gave this fivefold ministry. And he says the purpose of those ministries, it was to equip the church so that the church can do the work of ministry. And he adds so that we won't be blown there and there by false teaching. You are blessed when the Bible is open in the church that you belong. Never take that for granted. Outside there, people, they are blown up there and there. They don't know where they are. But here, we focus on the Bible. We focus on God, the constructor of this body. He is the builder, we not. Simote the boy. We help there, wherever he wants us to help. But he is the one who's putting his body, his church together. So spiritual maturity is necessary for the church to maintain unity and harmony in diversity. That is us. I need to grow up. You need to grow up. We're all responsible to grow up. Because if you're not growing up, you're going to cause problems in the church. Children, you can't do things for adults with them. They just think that you're ridiculous. They think the kid stuff is the best thing, so why don't you come and join them? And you say you need to grow up. Children say, no, come down. And that's a problem in the church. If we're not growing up, if we're not pushing ourselves to maturity, we cause the body of Christ not to function well. Which leads me to this question. Don't answer it. Are you part of the Bible study? The real question. Because if you're not, you should. Not because you can't study the Bible on your own, so that we can grow together as a body and function in a manner that honors God. And 1 Corinthians 12:31 is Paul's transitional verse to the next chapter, where he's going to teach us about love. That the hallmark of true spirituality is love. It's great. It makes me feel more comfortable because you God commands you to love me. That's wonderful. And he commands me to love you. If I don't, I'm disobedient. If you don't love me, you're disobedient to God. That's great. Okay. Here are the four things that I want you to take home. Number one, elevate your view of the church, child of God. Elevate the view of the church. You're part of something far bigger than all of us put together. God is building the church, his body. Your identity and self-worth is tied in you being part of the body. Just as the worth of a brick is tied in being part of the wall or the building. So you are. If you're not part of anything that God is doing, don't fool yourself. Your worth is tied in. You've been part of the church. That's what God is doing. That's what Jesus died to establish. And that's what he's building. And that's what Jesus is head of. He's head of the church, not of individual long range of Christians, but the church. Number two, a big eye, a big mouth, a big ear is not the body. It doesn't matter how big it might be, it's not a body. It can never be a body. Nothing can replace what the body is. It's just useless part that needs the body. I need the church as a Christian. I need this congregation in order for me to survive as a Christian. Then every Christian is equipped by God to serve him in some way. If you are not serving, you then at best leave this body of believers here at CCP handicapped and hindered to function properly. Fourthly and finally, don't use your gift and abilities in pride. Remember, they are given by God for saving the church. You are gifted to serve other members here, the church. So serve diligently and in humility. I'm saying those things to me, more to me, who's been given a position of serving here, that I never understood why God picked me up and put me to this position. I need to serve diligently and in humility. So are all of us. Let's bow our head. Father, we thank you that you are God who speaks. And we thank you that every time when we open your word, Holy Spirit, you open our minds. You teach us. And I pray that you will continue to teach us as we part from one another as a body of believers here. That you will continue to open up your word to each and every one of us individually. That you will continue to help us identify our gift, our role that you would have us play in your body here. Help us, Lord, to play our role so that we do not cause hindrance for this body to function in a manner that brings you honor and glory. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.